thanks for all coming to this session. The topic for my session would be a primer into virtual networking and SDN. So I would like to just talk about what virtual networking is and what SDN is. So this will be like our agenda for this talk. We'll talk a little bit about traditional networking, and then we'll go on and see what is virtual networking and why do we need SDN. And I'll take OpenStack as an example to just show like how it is done. Okay, so this is just like a recap. So we'll be talking mostly about the networking. Here networking means like you have your laptop or something and you are sending some traffic, right? You would want to connect to internet or whatever. So whenever your laptop generates a traffic, it will go via your Ethernet interfaces. So it will be nothing but a packet. And this will be the structure of the packet. We have an layer 2 packet, layer 3. You know, these are the various fields of a IP packet. So the layer 2 will have the Ethernet information, like the Ethernet source, MAC address of your Ethernet device, and what is the destination MAC address. And the layer 3 will have your IP information, like what is the source IP and what is the destination IP. Let's say if you want to say ping google.com, so your destination IP will be the IP address of Google. And the layer 4 will be your TCP or UDP protocols. You want to talk to any your HTTP service or whatever. So that information will be there in that. And L7 will be your actual application load, what you want to send and how the server would respond back, right? So the layer 7 is what is interesting to all the applications. And all the other layers are like handled by the underlying networking stack of your operating system, whatever you're running. So I just wanted to show that those fields. Okay, so let's talk about how the traditional networking happens. Let's say you are in your office or wherever. We have connected your laptop, so all of your colleagues are connected to the connected to the network, right? So you all machines can talk to each other. You can do a ping or whatever, right? So all that happens because somewhere you have a physical switch in your office campus or data center. That switch is what like. Switches the packet, sends the packet, forwards the packet, and you will have something called routers as well. Let's say you want to talk to your internet or you want to talk to some other IP addresses, you need routers which route the packet. And there are other stuff like, I'm not going into details about that, like what is WAN and all, but this is what like, traditional networking would have. So I would like to just talk a bit more on the what are switches and what are routers. So let's see what is a switch. As I mentioned about, we have a, you see a physical device over there that somehow would look like a switch. A switch has like various ports in it and all your laptops are connected to it, right? So you send a traffic and the switch receives the packet and it has to do something with that packet. So ideally, switch would just send the packet to other ports. What a switch does is it looks into your whatever packet it receives. It looks into the layer 2 packet, what I mentioned about. That layer 2 will have Ethernet source and Ethernet MAC. So it extracts that Ethernet source, it extracts the Ethernet destination MAC, and it learns that information. And it knows like where I should send that destination MAC. Suppose if it doesn't know, it just floods the packet to all the ports. So all the systems connected to that switch will receive the packet, and whoever whoever that packet is destined to will reply back. And that's how that particular switch actually will learn, basically, that, okay, I received a packet with source MAC as this, and it knows what is that port number, 1, 2, 3, so it kind of, maintains information something like this. So this is just an example, like, you have a switch there, which you have, like, three or four computers connected, each one have a MAC address, and it finally maintains it internally at a database or a table. So it knows that for this source MAC, I need, if the destination MAC is this, I need to send this packet to this port. So this is what like a physical switch does. It actually can do much more. I'm just telling about the basic stuff. Now let's talk about what the router is. So in the case of switch, it looks into the layer 2 packets, but whereas in the case of router, it also looks into the layer 3 packet, like what is the source IP and what is the destination IP. And it takes decision based on what information it has learned. Like if the destination IP address is this, forward it to this is what it would have learned. So that is what a router does. It looks into the layer 3 fields as well. And it learns all this routing information like through various protocols like BGP, OSPF, and stuff like that. So this is how a traditional networking thing works. In the case of data centers, what happens is that a network administrator basically wants to program the switches. He wants to control what ports he wants to enable, what kind of traffic he wants to allow or disallow, and stuff like that. So he wants to program those switches, right, and routers. So that's where there is something called as control plane and data plane. So what a network admin might do is he will program. So the switch exposes a control path. He can connect to the switch and configure and do some stuff like that. Like if you take Cisco switches and all, they will give an administrator, APIs and stuff like that. So you can log into that and configure. So that is called as control path, a control plane where you can program those switches. And data plane is nothing but whatever is programmed, it acts according to that. So if a packet comes, it has to take a decision. It takes that decision based on what it has learned through program, how it has been programmed. Based on that, it will take the decision. So the job of the data plane is simple, just to move the traffic. The packet comes, send here, receive, send here, stuff like that. But control plane gives the programmability. So, but if you see this traditional networking, so this control plane and data plane are like, are part of one particular switch. They are kind of, are there in one particular place. So there is no clear differentiation between them. So you need to access the switch and program and stuff like that. Now, now that we saw how traditional switching and networking works, now we are like in a cloud era where we have everything is virtual. You have virtual machines and Docker containers and stuff like that, right? So your VMs comes up and you need to give networking to them. So that's where like you need to program those things as well. So this is where the word virtual networking comes into picture. So virtual networking is the same thing, whatever switching and routing you do, but you do that in software. And you would generally do that in an x86 machine where you will run your switching surveys, routing surveys. So if you take a Linux platform, so Linux gives like a Linux bridge, which is an implementation of a software implementation of a switch. Basically, so it gives, you can create your own virtual switch by a command called brctl, create a bridge. You can add ports and stuff like that. So it acts as, it's nothing but a switch, but it is virtual. It runs as software. And we also have something called as OpenVSwitch. It is an open source implementation which gives the functionality of virtual switching. I'll talk a bit more about OpenVSwitch a bit later. So, and virtual router is also the same thing. As I said, instead of you have an appliance, which, the expensive appliances which do the routing, you can do everything as a service, as a software program running on some commodity hardware. So that takes care of, forwarding the packets, learning all the routes, using the BGP protocol and stuff like that. So typically all your SDNs will have these services. Let's take an example. You have a laptop, let's say, and you boot few VMs. You can boot VMs, virtual machines, using software like VMware or VirtualBox or KVM. If you have played with that, you would be familiar with that. So what it does is like you boot a few VMs, right? So you need to give networking to them. Basically, those VMs should be able to talk to the outside world. So what and that service is provided by, I'm talking here an example of libvirt, which is Linux virtualizing software. It has libvirt, KVM, and stuff like that. So as you can see here, I have booted up two VMs there. They have their own IP addresses internally. Okay, but when those VMs send a packet, the underlying Linux virtualizing software takes those packets, and then you know it. If you want to talk from one VM to VM, it's simple. It needs to send to this VM, right? So there is a virtual bridge over there which takes the packet and sends it to this one. So, and if you want to talk to the outside world, it provides. It uses the native Linux IP tables, stuff like that to route the packet to the outside world. And there's something called NATing and stuff like that, which is done. This is like, you have one machine, you create few VMs, so they have their own virtual, networking going on here. Before going to that, now let's say you have like, around many servers, right? And you want to put VMs on all of those servers or physical servers, and you want to virtualize everything, and all the VMs running over from one place to another would think that they're all connected, right? So that's where your cloud services comes into picture, like you have AWS or OpenStack, which gives you that option of creating such VMs. Like you can control your hardware infrastructure. Okay. So now let's talk about what is software-defined networking, right? So we spoke about what is a control plane and what is a data plane. So what software-defined networking is, like you want to basically separate this control plane altogether from the data plane. So there will be some service running in some servers, some machines, which acts as a control plane. And it actually exposes few APIs to the applications or the outside world, which they can talk to it and configure. And underlying, it takes care of, configuring the networking. So even if your control plane, goes down, by goes down, I mean that application which was doing this job dies or gets killed or whatever, your traffic, the underlying VM traffic or your service traffic will not get affected. And so it's very clear distinction. You have an application layer there which talks to the control layer, and it actually programs the underlying switches. Those can be virtual switches or actual physical switches. So, every SDN, mainly will have a northbound interface, northbound like your application interfaces, APIs, REST APIs, which you can talk to it. So that is called as a northbound interface. So any application wants to kind of create, it can create like virtual networks, it can create virtual ports and stuff like that. It would talk to the API and tell it that, can you create me a virtual network? With this subnet, with this IP address, can you create me these virtual ports and stuff like that? So it can talk to the northbound interface. And there is something called a southbound interface. This SDN, as I said, there is a northbound interface. At the bottom, there is southbound interface. So whatever the APIs it receives from the northbound interface, it actually converts them into southbound interface, which is nothing but the underlying underlying networking. It can be anything. Basically, there could be many SDN providers, or it can talk to physical switches, or it can talk to virtual switches as well, and program them. So basically, with that, your VMs, whenever they come up, they don't even know that they are virtual. Actually, for them, a VM comes up, it boots, it gets an IP address from the DHCP, it can talk. So all that is taken care underlying by the SDN software. So. The main thing in SDN is like the programmability, right? So you can administrator or the network, they can program and say that when this packet comes, if the packet is like a TCP packet with this port, I want you to do these things, or I don't want to allow ping to my servers, so drop any packet with ICMP packet or ICMP request. So all those things you can program. And tell. So that is what there is a protocol called OpenFlow, which gives you that option to program. OpenFlow is a protocol. As I said, it's mainly implemented in a switch or on a physical switch or on a virtual switch. You can just say that I want, as I said before, that I want this packet to be dropped. Give the programmability. Earlier, all that was inside a switch. It was quite limited, But now with the help of SDN, you can express things so that your VM traffic, you can control the VM traffic. Let's say you are a provider of infrastructure service, you can control. So, I mean, this is just one example wherein, you know, you say that if the source MAC is this and the destination MAC is this, do this. Or if it's a DHCP packet with this, you know, any DHCP packet is nothing but a UDP packet with source port 68 and destination 67, then you do this. You drop the packet or you send it to someone or you modify the packet and do this way. So that is what like OpenFlow does. And most of the switches, the hardware switches which the vendors provide, they claim that they support this protocol so that anyone can talk to that switch and program them, you know, and control that switch. So now let's talk about OpenStack a little bit. So OpenStack is like a you have various servers, and you want to control that those hardware services, and you want to virtualize them, and you give it as a infrastructure, so that you can anyone can boot a VM. I mean, example is AWS. A classic example is AWS, wherein you as a user can create your VMs. Once you create an account, you can create VMs, boot VMs, and do whatever you want. So you don't care where those servers are running, where those virtual machines are running, and all. You just need to connect to that and run your service. So this is what OpenStack does. It can be a public cloud, it can be a private cloud. Let's say you have various servers, you can deploy OpenStack on it and control it. So in the case of OpenStack, there are various services. Like if you want to boot VMs, there is something called Nova. Nova is a service which helps you boot VMs. And similarly, there is a service called Neutron, which takes care of the networking part. So what OpenStack does is like it gives you APIs, and you talk to those APIs and create your VMs, create your networks and stuff like that. So the new, I mean, as I was saying, that the networking service should give these many, these services. Like your VMs have come up, they can talk, they should be able to talk, they should be able to ping, connect. And when a VM comes up, it should get a DHCP service back, and IPv6 stuff. And you should be, as an administrator, you should be able to apply your ACLs or policies saying that I don't want my VM to. No one should be able to log into my VM, so you kind of restrict, or you don't want VMs to talk to the internet, you put policies and stuff like that. So all that OpenStack Neutron provides you the option. So the one thing is that it is quite dynamic, and even if you take like the Docker or Kubernetes, right, where the Docker services comes in, it's quite dynamic. Those containers come and go, those VMs come and go, so the underlying SDN should be able to handle all these things. So that is what the SDN does. So okay, it sees that okay, a VM has come up, it has to program the flows so that the VM has connectivity. So yeah, this is like you have these many servers, let's say an example. So this is, it looks this way before OpenStack, but then once you deploy OpenStack, you should be like able to boot VMs, and they should be able to talk. Like if you see here in the case, there are two colors. One is gray and one is blue. So those blue VMs are like from one user. He boots like three or four VMs, and they are spawned here, here, here. But that those VMs are like quite transparent. They don't know. I mean, the user is not even bothered. He should be able to talk to all those VMs here. They would have got an IP address, so he can talk to each of them. The same. But those VMs should not be able to talk to the gray VMs. So all that is like taken care by the OpenStack Neutron service. So let's talk a little bit about OpenStack, the Neutron. So this, so as I said, in SDN you have an REST API, it exposes, and there are various services the Neutron runs so that the VMs get connectivity. Like there are various agents, open vSwitch agent, layer 3 DHCP. I mean, those services, those are meant to give specific service. So underlying is what you have is like open vSwitch. So in the case of OpenStack Neutron, there is a reference implementation. I mean, it's an open source thing wherein we use open vSwitch to as an underlying virtual switch, and we program stuff. Okay. I'll take one example here. Like Neutron has various backends. Like Cisco will have one backend driver. Juniper could have one more backend driver. Or other vendors could have their own backend drivers, which they will talk to their own SDN services and give this functionality. So there's one such an SDN controller called OVN, which is part of the OpenVSwitch community, which gives the same functionality, and it's like open. It's like completely open source, and it's like community driven one. So it again has various services which run kind of the northbound and the controller services and the actual data services. So just let's try to look how does OVN work. So what happens is that you as an administrator would create networks. So there is something called northbound DB. And there is something called a service called OVN North 3, which actually whatever you write it into the northbound DB, it actually converts into southbound DB. And these are, let's say these are your all hypervisors, where you run your VMs or container services. Okay, so this actually connects to that, and it will come to know that. Okay, basically, yeah, you program there, and it gets all these, and it actually applies those programs using OpenVSwitch. So this is like a higher level overview of even any SDN controller. If you take it looks more or less similar, means you have a northbound service and you have various data plane services. Okay, let's try to see a little bit like how it works. Okay, so as you can, I don't know if you can see this, you want to create a network, using if you guys are familiar with OpenStack, it gives you APIs and CLIs to create a virtual network. So you just create a network called DemoNet. You create it, and it gets the Neutron OVN plugin will actually write it to the OVN Northbound DB, and it just writes it. And then you can create various subnets, and you can create ports. So those ports are nothing but like that port will have a MAC address and an IP address. So this is, at this point of time, these are like, logical entities. They are not physical entities, they are logical entities. And when you create a VM using OpenStack Nova service and you tell that I want to use this port, that's when the hooking happens. Like that, when that VM comes up, it will see if you log into that VM and see, you will see an ETH0 interface, and that ETH0 interface would have some MAC address, whatever you see here, and it will have an IP address, whatever is created in this in the port. Like if you see here, there is a MAC address and an IP address. Okay, so at this point, they are all like logical entities. You just created it using OpenStack APIs. It's just stored into the database. That's it. But when you actually boot a VM, right? So that's when the hooking happens. So here what I'm trying to say is that I talked about southbound DB, right? So there is an OVN North D service which actually looks into the northbound database and it converts into the southbound DB. So in the southbound DB, it will have information like how many hypervisor I have and how can I reach and stuff like that. OVN gives something called as logical flows. So whenever you create, right, it creates logical flows saying that for this particular import, do this and stuff like that. And when the actual VM comes up, it hooks up. I'm just trying to say that they can, when two VMs are in the same host, they can ping through this. And when, let's say, one VM is here, the other VM is there, and the packet will go through tunnels. So in most of the virtual world, you have something called as tunnels. It can be a VXLAN tunnel or an Geneve tunnel. Those are like, you encapsulate the packet. Like your VM sends a packet, your hypervisor receives it, but it puts that VM's packet in inside another packet and it sends it to the destination. Okay. So probably, yeah, I can skip that. So yeah. So as I said, you know, the hypervisors generate the actual physical flows. So when and how that happens is that in each, yeah, sure.
So if I'm sending a packet from the virtual device, will that get encapsulated with the physical device MAC address or the IP address as well?
Yes. So what happens is that, as I said, there are tunnels, okay?
Yeah.
VXLAN tunnel or a Geneva, those are nothing but layer 3 protocols. So on each hypervisor, you establish a tunnel between them. It normally runs in a UDP space, okay, on some particular port. So your hypervisor has layer 2 MAC address, it has its own IP address. Your physical hypervisor 2 has layer 2 MAC and IP address, right? So this knows, this particular hypervisor knows that if a packet comes, I need to send it to that. So how it does is, the VM packet comes in, so your virtualizing software like KVM or VirtualBox or whatever takes that packet, and it frames another packet with layer 2, layer 3 of this, and it embeds the VM packet in the layer 7.
Okay.
That is called tunneling.
Okay.
And it sends the packet. So the hypervisor there receives the packet. It can only see the layer 2 and layer 3 actual physical. Then it can figure out that it's a tunnel packet because it's a UDP packet, right? So it can figure out. Then it strips that packet, okay? And it gives and it gives the actual packet to the VM outside. So that's why the VMs are like quite transparent. So underlying, it's done by the tunneling.
Yeah, it's necessary because it helps in the routing.
Yes, and you can segregate the traffic as well. So one VM from one tenant cannot talk to the VM from another tenant. So all that programming is done by your virtual, like Neutron does it.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think I can skip all these things. So these are some of the other open source SDN controllers like Open Daylight, OBN, Open Contrail. I think it's called Tungsten now. So there are many other SDN solutions. Basically, they give the option to programming, and in the cloud environment you can segregate and you can program and stuff like that. So that is what I try to convey in this talk. If you have any questions. Okay, all right then. Thank you. Thanks for being patient. Cannot talk to the VM from another tenant. So all that programming is done by your virtual, like Neutron does it.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think I can skip all these things. So these are some of the other open source SDN controllers like Open Daylight, OBN, Open Contrail. I think it's called Tungsten now. So there are many other SDN solutions. Basically, they give the option to programming, and in the cloud environment you can segregate and you can program and stuff like that. So that is what I try to convey in this talk. If you have any questions. Okay, all right then. Thank you. Thanks for being patient.